Ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to Kinguin Pro League 2015. We're on week 9, second day of the week, which means it is officially the last day before the playoffs, where we'll have the quarterfinals, semifinals, and the finals. Now, for this day, we have a very special caster setup. We don't only have two, myself and Monk, but Masson is actually joining us to cast the games. So, yeah, that should be pretty nice for a last day casting.
Yeah, we kind of play the card gang up, so now there's three of us in here. I'm going to say hi, I'm gonna pass it off to Masson. What's up, Masson?
Hey, everyone, how are you doing? I'm just gladly here over, I think I was idle for 4 or 5 weeks, right?
Yeah, you've been missing in action for a while now, but it's glad to have you back on the scene. So that's pretty sweet, you're going to come back. I think this is the first time you and I cast together, if at all. So that's going to be nice.
Triple casting is going to be kind of funny. Go ahead.
Yeah, I have no experience triple casting, so hopefully we don't overlap too much on that note. We have about 6 matches today. I think we have 6. Dog versus Orange happened yesterday. It was supposed to happen yesterday, but we had to play a show match, Lothar and I, to compensate. So it got postponed. Both players agreed to put it to the end of today. Orange is going to be playing 2 matches, I think, today. And in the perfect circumstances, I think we calculate that it's possible, if everything goes wrong for every other player, that he goes up to the top 5. Something along those lines, right?
So basically, Orange has to win in his 2 matches. He has to win 6-0 in game score. And everyone else above him who's in contention for those spots has to go 0-6 or 0-3.
Yeah, it has to be a disaster for everyone but Orange on this glorious day. So he's going to be facing off against Dog and, I believe, in the first match versus Colento. So the matches today are actually really stacked. And this is a really important day because this is the last pre-playoffs day. Obviously, you know, Life Coach's spot as first player, considering it's tiebreaker, is pretty much secured completely. And now it's going to be a battle for the top 5 and the top 3. Colento and Trump are currently exactly tied for 4th place. Both players are going to be playing a match today, Trump versus RDU and Colento versus Orange. So this might determine if Colento can make it to, you know, top 3. If Hyped and Caldi lose, I think Colento can make it up there. But it's going to be about, I mean, there are players on the bubble, and it's kind of awkward because RDU is this close to getting to the top 5, which means he gets a reinvitation for the second season, and Orange just has to score nearly, like, just perfectly. So, yeah, bubble's pretty wide.
Yeah, so mainly today we're going to see Group Horde, which is kind of like Group B for the tournament, but there's actually one match from Group Alliance, which is Group A of the Kinguin Pro League, and that's going to be Kibler versus Gaara. What's funny about that match today is that Kibler actually, he can't make top 5, but Gaara can make top 5. So Gaara is actually, instead of battling Kibler, he's almost battling Savitz. Because if Gaara wins that match, then he advances. But if Kibler wins, then Savitz makes it to the top 5.
Exactly.
Dynamic there.
Gaara has to be like, you could dethrone Savitz. That's crazy. All right, well, I guess, the first match, Colento versus Orange. Orange is a player that in this league has had a really rough time, I think, one of the roughest times, with Frezar. Both players are really, and even Amaz had a really tough line of matches overall in the league so far. Both of the Archon players are at the bottom of the Horde group at the moment, and Amaz is playing versus Caldi today, so he's got a chance to maybe... we didn't really mention Amaz, but could Amaz make it to top 5 if everything goes well for him as well?
No, he's not going to. His tiebreaker is way too low, I think.
Alright, tiebreaker is going to just make it impossible for him to get there. Well, Orange could hope for the best, and maybe Archon will get a representation in the top 5 of Group Horde. Either way, Firebats and Alliance, you know, second spot, very well secured going directly to the semifinals. So Archon is going to have a representant in the playoffs that are going to be happening on, I believe... somewhere between 8th and 12th of May, so that should be a really really interesting finals. The players in first group are just crazy.
Yeah, we can kind of even give a preview of the finals right now. We have Strifecrow, we know from Group A, is going to make first place in that group. Then we have Firebat and Sho, so those three players are already locked in for the playoffs. Now, from Group Horde or Group B, we know Life Coach will be making the playoffs, and today we'll find out the remaining two players.
Yeah, Life Coach even, I think, gets a guaranteed ticket to the semifinals directly, unless I'm mistaken. His tiebreaker being that high above Caldi's could make it so he just straight up gets first place in the group, which means he just skips directly to the semifinals alongside Strifecrow, which means both players are in effect in the grand finals, gonna have to play one less match to get there. But that's always really important. In fact, Strifecrow's match yesterday, I think, was a really important match because it gave him a chance to win two games at once. If he won the match yesterday, which he did, it guaranteed that he didn't have to fight for the quarterfinal spot to the semifinals, which was really nice.
Yeah. Of course, the matches that we have for you today, I don't think we've talked about that yet. First, we have Life Coach versus Orange, then Caldi versus Amaz.
Whoa. Calento.
Calento versus Orange. Caldi versus Amaz. Hyped versus Life Coach. RDU versus Trump. Kibler versus Gaara, and Dog versus Orange. So a huge variety of players there. Of course, Orange playing twice. He's kind of having to remake the last week's matches as well. Now, you talked a little bit about Orange's inconsistency in tournaments before, and I kind of want to touch a bit more on that. So far, every tournament that Orange has entered, he's either dropped out in the first round or he's actually won the tournament. So yeah. Basically, just a stark contrast there. He's won ESL Katowice, first place. He's won C-Story Cup, first place. But Gfinity, he got out first round. In DreamHack Bucharest, he got out first round. And in Via Game, he got out first round. In addition, in the Kingwin Pro League, he's doing fairly poorly, I have to say here. So I'm not sure what's up there. Masan, do you have any insight there?
No, not really. But we have the deck list for Calento and Orange. Well, we don't have deck list. We have classes right now.
Yeah, we got.
Will be playing priest.
Go ahead.
Sorry, priest, rogue, warrior, and Orange will be playing druid, rogue, and warlock.
Yeah, both players are playing rogue, which means I guess it's a class that's kind of. I mean, Orange is known for playing rogue. Every single week, he just brings it. Hyped and Dog have been in a similar situation as far as rogue goes, but I think Orange is the player who plays rogue to a fault. Maybe. Shuffles the archetypes a lot, but Orange tends to bring very similar decks.
Yeah. Kind of a predictable priest from Calento. Priest is, these days, it's almost Calento's signature class because pretty much no one else in the scene runs just the standard control priest that everyone's been, no one's been using. He basically runs like two Shadow Madness, two Cabal, two Shrinkmeister. So it's like the full combo package of priest. Meanwhile, Orange sticking with the Archon mantra of just bring Zoo to tournaments. Of course, Archon is a team that has 6-0 in it, so you probably expect a lot of Zoo from them.
Yeah, they have a lot of refined Zoo decks, I'd imagine. I mean, the amount of players there that can brainstorm ideas back and forth makes it much easier for them to have solid decks to bring or offer to the players. Some of them might be working on specific archetypes and then offer them to the other teammates, so that does make a lot of sense.
I think the Archon is one of the only teams, if at all, they working truly as a team. Because all the other teams, as far as I know, worked as individual, Perspeed as individual, and Win as individual.
Well, it doesn't help. I mean, there's something to be said about the schedule conflicts sometimes that arise from having members of a team that live in different areas. Somebody from Europe might not be able to make practice time with somebody who lives in North America. So that's definitely a big consideration when it comes to practicing.
Yeah. You mentioned that Archon is a team that truly works together, and I have to agree with that mostly, but Orange actually is a player that's really known for playing a lot with his former Darkstar teammates. For example, I believe the person he plays with and practices with the most is Freaky, who will be competing with for Archon's Black Rock Mountain Team Brawl over this weekend, or next weekend rather. Oh yeah, no, it is this weekend.
Yeah, it is. I think it's even this week. Does it start on Thursday, the 2v2 Black Rock Brawl? Pretty sure that's the case. It's like a back-to-back. We have like KPL on Tuesday, Wednesday, and then on Thursday, I think we're ending up like with the Archon team brawl. That's going to be pretty crazy, to be honest. Like, it's the first tag team event so far, as far as I'm aware.
Yeah. Well, except for ESGN
way back
in the day.
That is so old school, Monk.
Yeah. But of course, after that team tournament, the very next week, we'll actually have the playoffs for the Kingwin Pro League, which will be on May 8th.
Right, yeah, this is going to be the big event for the Kingwin Pro League. It's going to be Season 1, like the very end of Season 1. We'll have six players, the top three of each group are going to move on to the playoffs. They're going to be casted directly from the Kingwin Studios. Now, the one thing is to be said about the format of the tournament. The last five players in each group is going, like, they're going to drop out. And they're going to open up for the Season 2 of KPL their slots. So in Season 2, we'll have not only, you know, the recurring players that are going to be reinvited from Season 1, but we're going to have 10 new players, so possibly new blood entering the scene, or, you know, known names that haven't been able to get into big tournaments before.
Yeah, I'm really excited to see who makes it in those 10 spots. I mean, there are a lot of players these days who have been just, like, qualifying for everything now. The two players that really stick out in my mind are Oskaka and Ignite. Both of those players, there were three open slots for C-Story Cup, basically, and both of them qualified. Also, for the recent ESL Legendary Series over the past weekend, both of them qualified. So to qualify for two big tournaments in a row, that's really impressive to me.
Yeah, and there's something to be said as well about the consistency of some of the players that have been picked up by teams as well, that used to just qualify nonstop. Like, Sixto is the perfect example, I think, where he played quite a bit of qualifiers and got through them very consistently.
Hassan, are there any other players that you're looking forward to for players that can qualify throughout future tournaments? Who are the consistent qualifiers? Or anyone that you really want to hype?
Yeah.
I'm putting my eyes on Faramir. He's been making out on qualifiers as well recently. He's been doing fine. I'm not sure if he qualified for Sistri or was invited.
He was invited.
Okay. But yeah, that's the... I think he's one of the players I'm looking out for.
Yeah. Well, Faramir, he is, like, along with Oskaka and Sixto, he used to be known as one of the players who qualified for everything. But these days, he hasn't been doing too well in offline tournaments. And in addition, he's mostly been getting invited to tournaments instead of having to qualify for them. So his reputation as, like, a qualifier god may have to be tested in the future.
Yeah, especially with the newer content is going to test a lot of people. Like, we're getting this week, in fact, I think tomorrow, we're getting the last wing of BRM put out. And if anything, it's actually a really impactful one. We're getting just Volcanic Drake, Solemn Vigil for Paladin as well, card draw engine. I feel like those cards, a lot of the cards that are coming out tomorrow will finalize a lot of the archetypes that are in the works at the moment by a lot of players. Some modifications on existing stuff could really spice up the metagame.
Yeah, I have to say, and this might not even favor a lot of players like Faramir. I think players like Faramir and Ignite, within the scene, they're actually known as some of the best technical players in the scene, but perhaps not the best deck builders. And they kind of, I would say, probably might struggle in a time period where these new cards are getting released, unless they have really, like, great practice partners that can help them build decks. I know Ignite has a really good support system with players like Luffy behind him, just to give him decks.
Luffy! Oh my god, I haven't heard of that guy in a while. That's actually kind of nice to hear the name. Now, what I find really interesting, though, is the metagame has been shifting for 5 weeks now. In, like, some weeks were much less impactful than other ones, but I think tomorrow is going to be the big drop. Like, Blackwing Corruptor, the Fire Elemental with dragons, the Volcanic Drake that can be summoned for cheaper if you have minions that die, Solemn Vigil as well. Sure, those cards have some drawback, but in general, I feel like their spot in mid-range decks could just be huge. It's completely crazy to me.
Yeah, I have to say that, like, really the only cards in Black Rock Mountain that have been really impactful so far are Emperor Thorazane, Imp Gang Boss, and Quickshot to an extent. But I feel like after all the dragon-related cards are released, that's when the dragon archetype can really take off. Like, you have Dragon Consort being released in Week 3, and various other dragon cards being released in the past 4 weeks. But unfortunately, without the complete package, it's really hard to make a dragon deck, especially in a metagame that's just so fast right now, with Phase Hunter, with Zoo, with Midrange Zoo, and even Mechmage is still in there.
Yeah, it's like the metagame it's shifted quite a bit, but with the advent of dragons, it didn't shift nearly as much as people expected. Dragon Consort didn't pick up, not nearly as much as I'd hoped initially, but I wonder if that's not just due to the absence of the Blackwing Corruptor in the metagame, because that card is, if you can get a neutral Fire Elemental, that's got to affect the metagame for midrange decks.
It's even cheaper too, 5 mana, 5-3, oh my goodness.
Yeah, it's crazy good.
Yeah, yet another class that hasn't really taken off is Shaman. I mean, Lava Shock was released, and then the Fire Guard Destroyer. Is that what it's called?
Yes, that's what it's called.
Yeah.
Nice job.
Yeah, yeah. Clap for me.
Another
yeah,
one of that those card... technical cards.
Yeah, those cards came out, but unfortunately, Shaman hasn't been really doing that well either. It's not like everyone's just dying to play Shaman these days, and I really have to feel like they probably need something else just to buff up that class.
Yeah, like make all the totems start with 3/3 baseline stats. I think that's...
Yeah, heroic that's... Shaman.
Yeah.
Has all the cards for Shaman has been released?
Yes.
Yes, they have indeed. That's the end of it. But then again, it might change things. You know, if they can get 2 Black Queen Corruptors and 2 Fire Elementals, does that change anything? Because they're the only class with effectively 4 copies of a Fire Ellie, if Dragon Shaman even becomes a thing. But, you know, 2 Drakes, 2 Azure Drakes could make it possibly work, but we'll have to see.
Well, you know, and lore-wise, that might make sense. Because Thrall is, like, in tune with the dragon aspects, right?
Right, yeah. It's like, to be consistent with the lore, you've got to make Dragon Shaman, like, a legit archetype. All right, so let's go back to the lineup about the first match, Colento versus Orange. I just want to look over the classes again. They're sharing Rogue. We talked about that before. Priest for Colento is a very standard thing. Orange brings Druid, probably still to this day the most consistent, most played deck. Like, if I'm thinking about a really strong, neutrally powerful deck in every metagame, I'm thinking of Druid midrange. And I don't think that'll change for a while.
Yeah, both players just bring very solid decks, I guess. And it's really interesting with these lineups because both players, they have really good matchups with some of their decks, but really bad matchups with other decks. Depending, it all depends on how the lineups match up, Kappa.
Thank you, admins.
I don't
admins.
Think Colento ever brought Warrior KPL, has it?
Grim Patron? Let's hope it's Grim Patron. That's all I'm
it's
saying.
It's gonna be Grim Patron.
It has to be. It has to be.
He never played Control Warrior, I don't think. He never brought
you
it
play
to
a lot
he
of
played it.
It,
sure. So I'm really surprised Colento even brought Warrior to the KPL.
Yeah, I like Grim Patron Warrior as a... I feel it's funny because a lot of players discredited Grim Patron as a terrible, I mean, terrible card when they saw it. They were like, oh, there's maybe a bit of potential in those, you know, casual games you're playing with your friends and you just enrage everything. And suddenly, you have, you know, rank 1 legend, top 5 legend decks with Grim Patron Warrior just working amazingly well. Then again, with the advent of the Last Wing tomorrow, we'll have to see if that still stands. Maybe the power curve of dragons, the tempo they give, and the beatdown they put up might be a bit of an issue, but we'll have to see.
Yeah, damage. That's gonna be a problematic for Green Patron.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, Green Patron Warrior. It's a deck that has been coming really popular lately. Ekop today, even he finished, or he didn't finish. He achieved rank 1 legend on EU with Green Patron Warrior, and so many people have just done the same. But the problem with Grim Patron Warrior, I feel these days, is oftentimes in tournaments and high-pressure situations, you often don't get to finish your turn, as we saw from Alesh over the weekend at DreamHack Bucharest.
Yeah, that was...
Judging from that, I actually really want to see Life Coach play this deck. Can you even imagine
goodness.
That?
Oh,
yeah,
my
well,
God.
He'll do it perfectly, right? Because he'll take, like, turn 1, and he'll have everything mapped out. So every time something comes up, he just, you know, he's got the... He's 2-3 steps ahead of anyone else who would be stuck on the same turn, right?
So basically, on turn 1, he's thinking, okay, on turn 9, I will play Warsong Commander and Grim Patron, attack into these 3 creatures that I know my opponent will have, and then play a Whirlwind.
Yeah, that sounds about right.
Like that. Sounds about right for a life coach.
Yeah, everything changes when you find Emperor Thorsen, though. One thing about that deck, and I think this is something about Emperor Thorsen that I haven't seen highlight too much, but the Combinatorix increase just too much to the point where you can't keep track or play around stuff that you otherwise would because it's going to be off curve a little bit. Everything being lowered by 1 when you have a handful of 8 cards and you have no idea what those are makes playing around specific combos just nearly impossible at some point. Like keeping track
especially
of the combinations is crazy.
How do you play around Force Nature Savage or Savage for 10 mana, right?
Oh, you don't. But even harder to play around.
Yeah.
Yeah. Even harder to play around is Grim Patron combos.
Right.
Because like people are not experienced with these combos really these days. Because it's such a new deck. And also like just the various combinations, like do you have to account for Whirlwind? Do you have to account for charging in an unstable ghoul? Do you have to account for inner rages? And especially after an emperor, that math just gets crazy.
Exactly, that's the math of it. It just blows my mind. When you play this deck, it's already complex enough. When you're playing against it and you're trying to play around stuff, it can be done, but there's a point where you just lose track of the possibilities.
You just have to keep on counting the cards used, not the potential at that point. It's really hard to play around things.
Yeah. All right, well, if Kalento brings... Like, we're talking about Grim Patron deck as though Kalento was guaranteed to bring it. I wouldn't be surprised if he did, since it's still pretty strong against a wide range of the metagame. Orange's Warlock, you said, should be Zoo, or at least is likely to be Zoo, since Sixto is practicing a lot of it on Archon. I'm just curious to see whether or not he's going to bring that or more of a mid-range or slash Weird Lock.
Yeah, I think these days Sixto has been kind of favoring the more mid-range Demon Lock. Mm-hmm. We've seen it in his KPL, yeah, in his KPL match last time against Savitz, I believe he played kind of a more mid-range Zoo with Mal'Ganis, with Dr. Boom, with Void Callers even.
Yeah.
And I actually haven't never seen Orange play Handlock or any variation of Demon Handlock or just anything in between. So I have to say probably that's going to be more of a leading towards a Zoo at least.
So like a fast mid-range deck or just straight up Zoo. So either or, generally speaking. Well, we'll have to see. I'm curious to see. Like if it's Zoo, how does it fare against Kalento's lineup? There's a Rogue there, there's a Priest, and yeah, the Grim Patron Warrior.
I think actually all three decks are going to be somewhat favored against Zoo. The only problem might be Rogue. I'm not really sure what the consensus on Rogue versus Zoo is these days after Rogue has gotten like a buff with Oil, with all the various new cards, and Zoo has gotten Imp Gang Boss.
Could Kalento play the Skulker? Could any of these players play the poor Dark Iron Skulker, the redundant Blade Flurry card?
Well, you know, like, every on stream these days, everyone's so excited about Dragon Paladin, about Fire Guard Destroyer Shaman, and even about Flame Waker Mage, that I actually haven't seen many players use the new Dark Iron Skulker before.
Yeah, and again, Zoo, it's got to be at least somewhat viable, I'd imagine, in some way, perhaps. I don't know. Maybe it's too late at the point where you play it and it's relevant.
Well, the thing is, everything has Death Rattle, so basically if you play that card, you give them a 4-4 Nubian Spider, you give them, two Spectral
Spiders.
You have
to prep afterwards and do something else. Okay.
And you give them, like, more demons from Imp Gang Boss, right? So everything... Like, you basically have to follow that up with something, and it's often hard to when you use a 5-mana card, right? So exactly, like you said, you might have to prep something after.
Yeah, I think there might be an argument to be playing a 1-of sometimes to surprise your opponent, because they might not play around it. If you don't have a Blade Flurry set up, you know, with a good Deadly already there, they might not play around the AoE, at which point I guess you're getting a semi-decent Fan of Knives just with a Skulker alone, but... We'll have to see if Kalento decides to bring something original. For the first game, we'll have Kalento playing Priest versus Orange's Druid. Now, Monk, you and I have said multiple times, every time we cast this match, Druid is so favored. Everybody says, you know, Druid is so favored, and it is. But the thing is, Kalento seems to pull off the wins against Druid with Priest almost every time.
Well, I'm not really sure if Druid is that favored anymore, to be honest, because when I asked Kalento about this matchup, he says the matchup is actually about 50-50, especially with the deck that he's bringing. And I think it's going to be a lot about if Orange can take an early lead, because Kalento's deck is so combo-focused that if he can get to, like, turn 8, for example, he can just unleash so many combos. I mean, usually, like, a Shadow Badness on a Sludge Belcher into Recombobulator is just game over.
Yeah, or I know like, that for a while he cut the Recombobulator, though, for Dr. Boom. I don't know if he reverted that change, but Dr. Balance made its way into Kalento's Priest.
I think little by little, like, Dr. Boom just seems to sneak into every single tech, right?
Yeah, I have it in my Face Hunter now.
8 damage to face, why not?
Yeah, exactly. It's 8 free damage. I don't even have to play Ragnaros for the chance of an 8 damage. You just play the Boom Boss and deal with it. That's about it.
Oh, my God.
Yeah. He thinks it's funny because he hasn't seen it happen.
I have seen it once.
Okay.
I just wanted to point out that Kalento didn't have the Recombobulator in his Priest last time he brought it. We'll see if he brings it.
Well, it's starting up, and Orange has kind of a decent hand, I would say.
Yeah, Wild Growth is actually pretty sweet.
Yeah, Wild Growth is very combo is sweet. Well, that is sweet, but he doesn't have any cards to start things with. He doesn't have four drive. He doesn't have Azure Drakes.
Kalentos found the injured Blade Master with Circle of Healing. That's got to be one of the best starts you can get against Druid, I think.
Yeah,
or against anyone,
much,
in fact, but against Druid, it's especially strong.
Pretty much the perfect start as the Priest player, because it's like pretty much impossible for Druid to deal with it unless they have a Sylvanas on turn 6, perhaps.
Or Innervated.
This could be turn 5. That orange hand, though, he has Force Nature, Savagery, Assassin.
Don't worry, Emperor Thorsten is around the corner, man. Just don't worry about it. Emperor's right there waiting. So Kalento's not opting to coin out the Injured Blade Master. I think his plan is to go for the Injured Circle into Coin Belcher. But
yeah,
we'll have to see what he ends up doing.
Shade can be played this turn, and I think it probably will be, but it's kind of dangerous.
Yeah, against Pyromancer.
Like, you know your opponent has the coin, and if he has any other spell, like even like Light of the Naru or of course Power Word Shield, then he's just gonna be able to kill it. This is kind of an awkward turn here for Kalento. He knew this was a risk going into the next turn. Basically, what he was almost hoping for was that this Wild Pyromancer got keepered, so he could Injured Blade Master Circle and then trade off the Blade Master with the Keeper, and that would have been an okay position for him. But now that the Wild Pyromancer is on the board, if he uses the Circle of Healing now, he'll actually do one damage to his entire board.
He could kill it with the coin afterwards, though, if you wanted, but keeping the coin for a Belcher or Cabal Shadow Priest is probably a bit better.
Yeah, it's...
gross.
Exactly.
So Orange can board clear if he wants to. I don't know if he wants to, though, because the Lothab is just really, really strong at the moment. And
yeah,
that prevents the opponent from playing things like Coin Power Shield.
Yeah, and even if he board clears, he gives up his entire board here. So he's basically like... he's basically giving the Priest initiative, which is something you never want. In this matchup, you always want to have initiative as either player. Because if the Priest gets a board, then he can just heal up his entire board for pretty much forever. And if the Druid gets initiative, then the Priest will have to be able to deal with the board, plus hopefully develop some of his own board in the coming turns.
Do you agree with the attacking into the 4-3, though?
I think it kind of makes sense, because you're really afraid of like healing the Blade Master, but I see what you're getting at, because like the Lothab can trade into the Blade Master next turn, right?
And even if he heals, it's still 4 or 5, so it's not really going to die. And it's like Priest that has any extra ping damage.
Oh,
so.
Two Wild Pyromancers here. Like, what I'm curious about, though, is like, what's the value of them at this point besides the 3-2 body? I don't think he'll ever get to use them. He's obviously has... he kept the Circle of Healing for the Akanai, so it's obviously going to be for Board Clear some point down the line when he feels threatened.
Yeah, I don't
draw
think...
with it.
Wow!
The clear!
Wow!
Wow, nice top deck.
Pretty good.
And next turn he has the... Wow, this is just insane.
Look at this guy's deck is crazy.
Oh my goodness.
Yeah. Generally, Wild Pyromancer isn't really impactful in this matchup, so you might as well play it as 3-2s, right?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. It's that's what it is.
Yeah. Orange got kind of lucky here, drawing into the Ancient of Lore. It's exactly what he needed on turn 7 to refill his hand.
But he had it on turn 4.
Oh
yes,
my goodness.
Oh my
double
goodness.
Shredder for turn
that
8.
This is crazy. Just play it on turn 8 and then force it after turn 9. How can Kalento deal with this?
I mean, there's an Akanai Circle if that can help at all. Which it should be able to eventually.
It should.
But you might just have to play everything right now.
Yeah, the problem here is if you Akanai and just hero powers here, then it's kind of a risk for him, because if the Akanai is cleared, then he has no way to activate the circle. And I feel like Kalento, in order to, like, quote-unquote, come back into this game, he needs to be able to get a good Akanai circle off.
What if you Akanai...
He can also Dust Hill into maybe a Wrath, but that's not really... up. He's going for Dust Hill.
Keeper of the Grove would do it, right?
Yeah, you're right, because he has a
Oh,
coin.
Well... That's pretty good.
Yeah, he's gonna be forced to Akanai here, though.
Akanai in circle here, I guess.
Yeah.
Oh dear.
It's bad, but at least he's alive, and he found really strong. Like, the Sylvanas he just found here is going to be a really big problem for Orange at the moment.
Sylvanas and Emperor, two of the best things you can thought steal, pretty much.
Yes.
Like, Emperor and Priest, like, even though typically it's too clunky, if Kalento can ever find a favorable position to just throw down the Emperor, like, these combos will even be even better here. Oh. Dr. Boom!
Well, there's
a
BGH.
Dr. 7.
Yeah, Dr. 7 is balanced.
Mm-hmm. Well, he does it. There's a BGH, though. So, and he has 6 mana after. That actually is possible. So just hero power to one of the bombs and then go for Shredder and Dr. Well, BK Hunter.
You just punch the face as hard as possible to set up the Force of Nature Savage skill, I think.
Do you agree with the playing Shredder first out here?
Oh, it kind of makes sense, because you'd rather the bombs hit the Shredder than hit the Azure Drake, right?
Well, they're going to hit the Drake anyway, right? Is that how it
of
works?
Of course. I guess that's how it works.
Or three... Oh, wow. Three damage.
Whoa.
Almost.
Well, that was just... Oh, well. All right, well, if that Shredder pops, Shadow Madness could come in handy.
Oh, yes, definitely. Will it? Oh, no, it didn't.
And is that just game over?
I think it might be.
It is.
Yeah.
Unless he...
No, there's nothing.
Can you survive anyway? 26 damage. Yeah, it's not... Yeah, that's just game over.
Yeah, that's basically impossible. And it's... yes, Force of Nature, Savage Roar will come down here. So, unfortunately, Sylvanas won't do anything here. And Orange will take game one. And I have to feel like it all has to do with... Wait... Did he just attack?
Did I see a trade? Okay, no, I did not. I was really confused there for a second. Either it's the ultimate BM or just a misclick. All right, so Orange did in fact get the win, so that's 1-0 for him here. The Druid being locked out is going to allow Kalento to get probably potentially better matchups with the Priest, though, because he's going to be facing off against Warlock and Rogue. I know that Rogue is typically not an amazing matchup for Priest, but if anybody can pilot a Priest deck to a good win rate against that, it's probably Kalento at this point.
Yeah, Kalento's Priest deck, unfortunately, his signature deck is kind of failing him at this point. I do feel that, though, I maybe have to disagree with you in that he can get a win with Priest, because every time I play Priest, it's just basically the worst matchup in the world, Priest versus Rogue.
Yeah.
Rogue can just always develop these huge Blade Flayers, and I don't even think that, like, Orange has even the slightest bit of chance, or rather, Kalento has the slightest bit of chance with the Priest, honestly.
Well, Wildpower Mentor could help with Vile Teachers, and two Shadow Madnesses might make up for the Vile Teacher plays as well. I'm not too sure exactly how those turns generally pan out, like, as a given, yep. But between the Arcanize, like, he's really playing a control-heavy deck. I know that's pretty weak to Rogue in general nowadays because of the burst they set up, but I'll have to see what... I don't even know what type of Rogue was brought by Orange. I don't know. It's got to be probably the type that he always brings, or Rogue.
Yeah.
So around.
Well, there's, like... Actually, there's different variations of Rogue these days, even. There's Standard Oil Rogue, there's Gajusan Rogue, which Orange has been known for bringing to tournaments, and there's also more of the more minion-based Rogue, which I feel kind of struggles more against Priest, because it just gives more things for Priest to interact with, more minions on the board for Priest to interact with. Like, they add Sludge Belchers, which can get Cabal'd or Shadow Madnessed. They add Dr. Boom, which can get Shadow Word Death, so... Probably a worse version of Rogue to bring. But that being said, I don't think Orange will be bringing that style of Rogue. I haven't actually seen him put Dr. Boom and Sludge Belcher into his Rogue, like the Mr. Yagut style.
Yeah, what I wonder though is...
Go ahead. It's very unfortunate that Druid won the game and then it's out of the game, because the other matchups, the Kalento's Rogue and Warrior can... Well, Warrior versus Druid is, unless it's a control Warrior... It's I would say it's probably, I wouldn't say very strongly, but favored for Warrior. At least that's what I've been hearing. And Rogue depends on the deck. Druid these days play a lot now with brings the Druid Drakes instead of Lothab and the other five drops instead of two Belchers. So both Rogue Warriors should be favored versus Druids that Orange brought, but it's not there anymore. So it's very, very unfortunate for Kalento right now.
Yeah, I'm wondering if Orange tried to target the Priest from Kalento, because Kalento's been bringing it every single time. So if this is a Handlock deck, for instance, I think the deck that he's like Kalento has, even the Priest deck could have a bit of trouble with that. That's one of the weaknesses of it. Unless the Warlock lets the Priest draw, you know, as much as he wants, it's typically a handlock win. So if Orange targeted that specific deck, Druid Rogue Warlock, if it's handlock, makes perfect sense.
Yeah, it's actually possibly a really good point. Yeah, in Kanguin Pro League, because you can bring one set of decks and one lineup against every player that you face, it's very common, especially in the later half of Kanguin Pro League, for players to just target each other. Basically, if one player is known for bringing a certain deck, like Hyped is known for bringing Rogue, and off the top of my head, some players are known for bringing Face Hunter, and Kalento is known actually for bringing Priest. So you can just actually just bring three decks that are really good against that class that these players are known for and just kill that right away.
Yeah.
Orange, though, as we mentioned before, he's never played handlock in a tournament that we've seen, so it might be something uncomfortable for him if he's deciding to bring that deck.
Yeah, we'll have to see. There's a lot of lines of decision during the game of a handlock player.
I can kind of agree Orange could have brought two snipe players instead of necessary decks out there at the moment. Orange brought Hunter, Rogue, Druid versus Clint Lodge, and he brought Freeze Mage, Face Hunter, Warrior against Reynid. And against RDU, he brought Rogue, Druid, Face Hunter. I guess that's the same thing. But he's bringing various kinds of decks. He never stuck with the, except that once, he never stuck with the same three classes or two. So it's possible, but then he's also always been bringing those most classic the decks out there, Face Hunters, yeah, Midrange Druid.
But against RDU, you make a really good point, because that lineup you're mentioning, you know, Rogue, Face Hunter, Druid, that's like RDU plays a lot of Freeze Mage, and those three decks could do really well against Freeze Mage, even if Face Hunter is slightly disfavored when the mage finds, you know, the two Ice Barriers very early. They can steal games very easily from the deck, and there's really, like, Warrior's not a deck that he plays a huge amount of, so that you're right. He just snipes the opponents, which in Conquest just makes a ton of sense.
Yeah, we do have the next classes that both players will be bringing. It will be Kalento bring his Warrior. Again, we don't know what Warrior that is, what kind of Warrior, rather, and Orange will bring Warlock. And yet again, we don't know what kind of Warlock that is. But I will say that it's really refreshing for two players to bring two different classes, and we just don't know what each class is, because these days, pretty much except Oil Rogue, every class has different archetypes.
Yeah, I guess Rogue does have the aggro deck that Hyped brought, but I think it's more like Hyped has multiple Rogue archetypes, and that's it. But the metagame doesn't really at this point.
Yeah, all right. I have to agree.
Yeah, Shaman as well, I think, is pretty much stuck on mech at this point. Like, there was a Fellreaver variant. Fireguard Destroyer made its way into a few deck lists, but the, like, mid-range Shaman has gone mech. A lot of people just play that version instead.
Yeah, even
in tournaments, I have to agree, but on ladder, I would say I have to disagree a little bit. Silent Storm has late ladder rank 3 NA on NA with the mid-range Shaman, with the Destroyers.
Okay,
so
maybe that's
impressive.
That's good. That's really good for mid-range Shaman stuff that I haven't seen that deck, you know, walk around too much. I know mech is everywhere, but mid-range Shaman is not a deck I've seen a lot of.
Yep.
Wow. Well,
we're going into game number two, and it's actually going to be Zoo against probably just a Control Warrior from Kalento, because there's Shield Maidens.
Yeah, Control Warrior. I'm very surprised. It's yeah, mid-range-ish Control Warrior too, with the Shredders, instead of having all the 7s and 8s.
Does that just stop the Rogue? Did Kalento... No way Kalento targeted a Rogue with this lineup. Not with a Priest in there.
Yeah, I think Kalento might just... He is targeting Rogue in the sense that he's bringing the Warrior to beat the Rogue. But again, it just all kind of plays into this matchup, or... this series between these two players is just so matchup based, because pretty much every deck that each player is bringing has a good matchup and a bad matchup.
It kind of feels like I'm watching Last Hero Standing at this point.
Yeah.
Kind of a slow start.
Oh, man.
Start by Kalento.
Very slow.
Yeah, but yeah, at least he has this Shield Slam into this Death Spite or a Piloted Shredder, and he can follow that up with a variety of options.
Oh my goodness, Deathbite. Actually, that's really good right now for Clint. Deathbite's gonna kill both Imp Gang Balls and everything comes out.
That's just gonna be perfect.
Yeah.
He's gonna kill the
endgame
boss.
It also kills off the spiders. Yeah.
Unless Voidwalker is played the next turn, which I have to probably suspect will be. Oh, Voidcaller comes down though. Ooh. I don't think that's good though. Yeah, I don't think that's good.
Would he be risky? I mean, he doesn't have really any other play besides live tapping, which he just did. So we'll go with the Voidwalker play here.
Wait, could he play the Sea Giant next turn if things lined up? No, there's no way. Because then now the spider doesn't get popped. He would have been like two mana off. Well, Bane of Doom. I wonder how big of a card that is here.
Yeah, I think it's going to be huge. Attack. I think Bane of Doom is going to be used the next turn. The most likely play I see here is just like a piloted Shredder, right? And then spiders plus Bane of Doom will be able to trade it into the Shredder, and then Mul'Ganis will pop out.
And there's no BGH. Oh, what's he gonna do? What do you do without BGH here?
All right, the best card
Bane
in the game.
Bane of Doom coming out. Is that gonna be? What is it gonna be?
Play me. Oh no!
Milhouse.
Oh no!
Oh man, this little gnome's going to wreck the day. This is probably the best outcome for Kalento. He's getting a second better Shredder almost at this point, and Orange hits one of the worst. I mean, it's not a Blood Imp, mind you, but it's not the demon he wanted. At this point, I wonder if Voidwalker wouldn't have been more relevant. But
yeah, just kind of almost unfair RNG here. Pretty much, Orange got, I believe, either the third or fourth worst one. Like, he would have preferred Orange. It would be worse if he got like Mistress of Pain, Voidwalker, or Blood Imp. So I guess this is the fourth worst. Meanwhile, yeah. Kalento probably got either top two or top one. Like, maybe Explosive Sheep or Unstable Ghoul would have been better.
Right.
But I think he'll take like pretty much the number three choice he would have gotten versus one of the worst choices that Orange would have gotten.
The Sea Giant can't come down here.
It can, but after that...
Yeah, I don't know. Yeah, it's so vulnerable to a single counterplay from the Warrior. You're going to be in a world of hurt. Like, one BGH, one, you know, Cruel Task Execute. A Shield Slam even could come out at this point. You know, a good armor up, Shield Block, Shield
but
Slam.
But he doesn't really have any other better plays, I think. What are the six drops? Can you don't want to... You definitely don't want to play Sylvanas here. Maybe you can Argus with a Life Tap.
What about Power of Whelming to kill the Shield Maiden, then you trade and play Voidcaller? Just as a body? I don't know.
Possibly. Just as a body.
Gonna see a Sea Giant.
Sea Giant.
There it is.
And Ghost or Face.
And fortunately, Kalento doesn't have an answer.
No, he does not. But he can try to draw into it.
Yeah, isn't Shield Block an answer here?
Shield Block, Shield Slam.
Because Shield Block will obviously draw Shield Slam, right?
It does, yeah. Every time.
Yeah, every time it does. Oh, no, it didn't.
Yeah, I think he cheated. Well, honestly, though, even if the Sea Giant stays up, at this point, it's sort of okay for Kalento. His board is not very vulnerable, and he's getting armor when he does trade stuff away.
He actually has a better board right now than Orange, even with the Sea Giant.
Yeah, also, like, there's no good way to clear out this Armorsmith. Like, you probably want to attack face here, right? You want to peel off some of that armor so that shield block, or rather shield slam, is a dead draw on the next turn.
You know that your opponent... do you know your opponent doesn't have it? I think so. You know your opponent doesn't have shield slam, so
100%
is there any reason to attack face instead of going for a board? Because you want to really establish that board right now.
You do activate execute, though, if you attack the armorsmith and you lose out 8 damage, so... That
but he
would have
done it, right?
I don't know if he would have, because...
He would have done it because he has execute.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, you're right. Cruel Task plus Execute.
Goes for face.
For the face! Hunter mode enabled.
Yes.
Well, let's see what Kalento finds here.
We hit face.
Yeah. Orc, no, stupid. All right. Well, Kalento's going to be getting some armor.
For sure.
Yep. I really like Cruel Taskmaster on the Shield Maiden, and then trade with the Cruel Task and the Shield Maiden away into the Sea Giant, then just play Sylvanas.
Yeah,
actually, like
that doesn't
play.
Seem bad at all. You just
or,
get so
or
much
other options you have is, you know, going for a Ragnaros after killing Egg. hope for the best.
Yes. That sounds like a great idea, Masan. If you want coaching from Masan, just hit me up. I'll hook you up with a good price.
Yeah. Masan's coaching is basically, I would play Ragnaros here. But I'm like, Masan, this is turn one, and I'm a druid player.
Well,
why
no
am
problem.
I playing Ragnaros?
Because you're going to join to innovate, right?
Yeah. All right, he does go for the trade here. I think it makes a lot of sense. Now, if he attacks the egg here, he gets punished somewhat because of the follow-ups, but...
Mm-hmm. Will we see a YOLO play here?
Oh,
with
my goodness.
The Power of Whelming play?
Yeah. Sylvanas, Power of Whelming. On the Sylvanas, trade into the Cruel Taskmaster and hope for the 50-50 that you steal your opponent's Sylvanas.
If you do, how far ahead are you?
You probably want to just go for the Power of... If you want to do that, I think I'd rather go for Power of Whelming on Argus and kill Sylvanas. So hopefully he takes your own Power of Whelmed Argus.
Yeah, but you can use it for a turn, though, right? He's got a turn to use it.
Yep. Yep, Power of Whelming.
Yeah, there's no YOLO play. I have to say I'm quite disappointed. But it's a more stable play with PO and then trade pretty much everything away. Actually, yeah. How does he sacrifice Sylvanas afterwards? Clento can't.
Here it goes. Oh.
Oh, that was interesting.
Yeah, that's what he has to do. Sylvanas that way can't be enabled right now. And he might be able to steal her almost guaranteed next turn.
Yeah,
he
and
he might be able to.
Yeah, if a legendary even comes down, then it will also be guaranteed that that Orange will actually steal this Grom.
Oh, goodness.
Or Sylvanas.
Actually, no. Oh,
actually,
wait.
No. This Void Call is actually making that difficult.
Yes.
What? Oh, my God. Is this real? Is this hand real? No, you can't trade away the Void Call. What if the Void Terror comes out? Look at this Void Terror.
This is actually really awkward. Like, Orange doesn't want this Void Caller to have an effect.
No, you just Power Overwhelm your Void Caller into Grom, then you play Sylvanas. No, you can't do that. Oh man, there's like one PO missing. But if this summons the Void Terror, he's gonna be... Because the Void Caller was played first, right? Or after?
No, Sylvanas was played first.
Oh, then it's great. He wins.
Yeah,
every single time. This is perfect for him.
Yeah, you can just tap, and then...
Sylvanas.
Yeah.
Yeah, Sylvanas, Power Overwhelming.
Oh,
where's your execute?
Yeah, unfortunately, you don't get the charge, but I think he'll take this.
Still get the charge, it's just opponent's turn.
Yeah, wow. Now Masan, what's the play here? Tell me what the play is.
Oh, wow.
Execute!
And reg.
And?
When in doubt.
Execute and reg. There's no other play, it's just so good play. I think this won him the game right now, right here.
I don't even... Actually,
deck, though. Holy crap.
That's not bad. Oh, wow. What a
wow, that's
deck.
A counter.
Yeah.
Yeah, I would it's still anyone's game now because Orange is playing more of the mid-range zoo.
Nah, I would say the client is still by far favorite right now.
Well, he just got a top deck shield block, so. Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Hindsight is pretty good.
What is hindsight?
Yeah.
How do you hind? Alright, so I guess the Acolyte of Pain will come out to eat up those Boombot hits.
Yep. In case Rag hits a boom. Oh no, it doesn't.
No.
Wait a minute, that's even better!
Yeah, that's actually even better than what he has.
Yeah, that's even better. Oh my god.
You know, the implosion would be great. If you could get a Void Caller out with Mal'Ganis. But he's gonna opt for Flood the Void approach.
Which makes sense. He has a lot of death rolls here, and I don't see a way that Kalento can pull Void Caller right now.
Well, this is a predicament.
Yeah, that's actually a bit annoying for Kalento.
It's very annoying, actually.
Don't you just punch face and play Baron Geddon?
I think I will kill off the... I think I will kill off the owl and get Emperor down.
Yeah.
Hero power.
I think
just play
it's
a little slower.
Play.
What does the Emperor really do, though?
It reduces the cost of Baron-Geddon to where you can play an Armorsmith and an Armor Up on the same turn.
Wow. Wow. That boom hit.
The Hero Acolyte.
So Noxious, he's definitely going to draw Armorsmith next turn, right?
Yeah, he is. Of course.
Uh-oh. Oh.
Wait, does that do anything?
It doesn't do anything this turn, but he brings out the Mahogany so he can Knife Tap for free and Implode Join is kind of bossy.
Whoa. If the Boombot hits Emperor for three.
Wow.
He's free too.
You
can play everything here.
He can vomit his hand.
Yeah, Flamen is actually a really good draw here.
It's the best.
It's a 5-4.
And he hits for three.
Oh no.
Oh, Kalento.
All of a sudden, everything's just going so wrong for Kalento.
And Baron-Geddon needs to find his assistant, the Whirlwind, to do anything here. Or a BGH, you know, that would also help.
Or even a Silence would have been good here, but... Yeah!
You just have to pray and...
Oh, I think this is going to kill Mal'Ganis, right?
I mean... every target here is bad.
It's an egg. It's either best or worst, right?
Yeah.
I think Rag is gonna go face.
Oh, wait. <It's> the...
I think 7 times out of 8 it hits Mal'Ganis. That's what I vote for. That's where I cast my vote.
The funny thing here is if Kalento plays Baron-Geddon and
it hits Mal'Ganis first?
Yeah.
Goodbye board.
Exactly.
Oh, you're right.
Then Kalento would be winning. So Kalento, actually, with this play, he has a 1 in 7 chance of just, the worst one! And I think that's it!
Yeah, that's game. Oh, wow, that Mal'Ganis for Orange did so much work. And Kalento chooses death. Does he want to go through the process of getting punched in the face repeatedly by little 1-1s? Oh, well. That's unfortunate. So Orange is going to be 2-0 up against Orange. Yes, that's right. Against Kalento. And Kalento's got all his lineup left, but Orange is down to his one rogue deck.
Yeah, I think Orange is going to be super favored going into the next matches. He has rogue against like a priest. And even though Kalento has a warrior and he has an opposing rogue, it's just that priest matchup is just going to be the end of days for Kalento. It's going to be so difficult for him to beat rogue with his own priest.
I agree.
I definitely am. Yep. Yeah. I agree.
Yep, you do. You agree. All right. That's
we
nice.
All agree.
I'm just curious, though. Agree. Like, because I remember seeing Kalento tech in Harrison Jones in his priest deck a while back. If he still plays it, knowing that Orange is likely to bring a warrior deck or a rogue deck, that could give him a slight. Not an edge, because obviously he's not going to be ahead, I think, in the matchup nonetheless. But it's going to help a little bit in the matchup, for sure.
Yeah, I feel, though, like, still, even with Harrison Jones and Lotheb, you're still at a disadvantage against Rogue. That's just how bad the matchup is. And normally, I would say that in this format, in this league, you want to get as many games as possible just to increase your match differential. But at this point, I actually don't believe it even matters for Kalento, right? Because it is the last day.
It is the last. It is the last.
For Kalento, it doesn't matter. For Orange, it matters specifically. He needs to go with 6-0, like I said, right? Yeah.
Exactly. So,
although Kalento could get into the top three if Hyped or Kaldi loses, I think. Yeah, Kalento could get top three if he wins this series.
Yeah.
There's a possibility.
And everyone else today fails, right?
Could Kalento lose the top five if Trump and Dog win?
Oh, yeah, definitely, I have to say.
Wow, Kalento could actually not get reinvited for season two. You know, this match is actually more important than
Kalento
initially.
No, can't lose top five because he already had secured for himself 5 wins. And best possible scenario for... Wait, is Dog playing one today?
Yeah, he is. He's playing a game today, so...
Wait a minute,
if Trump wins and Dog wins, is Kalento still ahead of Dog? I think depending on the tiebreaker that Dog gets...
Oh, no, it's not. Because Dog has to win 5 games today.
Oh, man, too many combinations here for my brain to handle. You'd have to have them on the fly, just calculated preemptively. I just feel like if Orange manages to get a 6-0 and everybody else just fails miserably and he ends up in the top 5, this is going to be the biggest upset... Like, as far as my expectations went for the entire league, for sure.
Yeah, you expect Kalenta to just dominate everything, right? Like, I mean, the two expectations were, like, Strivecoach would do really well, and I think everyone thought that Life Coach would do really well. And they've really kept up their promises. They've really kept up their hype. But Kalenta just hasn't been fulfilling that hype, right? He's been winning tournaments lately, like the Gamers Origin or the Gamers Assembly tournament in France.
Right.
He's won EU versus CN. But outside of that, I mean, yes, he did win two tournaments, but outside of that, he hasn't been doing too well in Kingren Pro League and in other tournaments.
He had a really rough start, to be honest, though. I think he went 0-3 for the first matches, which means he's got, like, after that point, like, the bad variance at first, even if it stabilizes, once you get the first losses, I think it gets really tough in a league format to just climb and streak high wins. It's just the variance will hit you eventually. But I have to say, I think Kalenta is going to be able to take at least a win here with Warrior versus Rogue. That's a very good matchup for him. So it's unlikely that Orange is going to be able to go 3-0 here. A Warrior is a massive roadblock to a Rogue deck.
Yeah,
especially
but then again,
with the cards like Polish Shredder. That card is really against Rogue.
Yep.
Well, it's good against Warrior, too.
Oh, yeah.
Is it bad against anything? Just find me one class against which Paladin Shredder is bad. One class, Monk. I challenge thee. Oh, Hunter. Face Hunter. It's too slow.
Face
That's
Hunter,
right.
Yeah.
There we go. Okay, never mind. I got head. Yep.
Or if you get... Well, against a Rogue, if you get... What's that 0-4? Cho, Milhouse. No, not Milhouse, but the Cho.
Lorewalker Cho. Milhouse Cho. Yeah. They go so well together, you confuse them, right? They're like the ultimate combo.
If you can have Valkyrie with it, oh my god.
Well, yeah. You know what? It is worse against Priest than Chillwind Yeti. Because you can like Shadow Madness it with the Shriekmeister. And you can kill it off and then Cabal whatever comes out, right?
Yes, you're right.
Well, if you Shrink Master and Shadow Menace, you don't even need to use Cabal because...
Cabal, yeah. It's even better
it will just
kill
on your board, so you get the Death Rattle.
Alright.
Exactly. Well, I'm just saying any combination of those two cards.
Oh, yeah.
Or those two cards,
you're right.
Make Yeti better than Pilot of Shredder in that matchup.
Alright, so Kalenta will be going for Warrior here, and Orange is, in fact, going to stick to his Rogue being in his last deck. So Kalenta taking Warrior doesn't surprise me one bit. I think at this point what he wants to do is... get as many wins as possible, if only for the tiebreaker security, if anything. And at this point, since he's down, you know, two losses, he wants to make sure that he gets the possible reverse sweep. And this will only happen if he wins the first game, and Warrior is the best way to do so.
Yep.
The Priest matchup is going to be so difficult.
Yeah. Kalenta's just leading with his strong guns right now. He wants to... I guess he still really values the tiebreaker right now. Because who knows what can happen in future round or for the rest of the day, right?
Yeah, I haven't calculated every combination, but I think there's a chance he gets knocked out of top five. If Orange wins and everybody else also does, then there's a possibility that he gets knocked out.
Yep. Oh my god! Let's look at the starting hands. Hold up. There's
a
dragon
here.
Yes, Dragon Rogue. I believe it's Malik God. I believe.
What? I think. Rogue, this actually makes sense. I think Hungry Dragon is probably best, in my opinion, either in Rogue or in Paladin. It has weapons, or these classes do have weapons like the Light's Justice and just the simple dagger that can clear off the one drops that Hungry Dragon summons.
Yeah, it's the deck I've had the most fun with since the advent of the Dragon, the BRM, has been Dragon Rogue with double Azure Drake, double Hungry Dragon, and Malygos as a... It's kind of an old school finisher, really.
Mm-hmm. It also kind of makes sense because Rogue has so many AoEs that they usually run two Fennel Knives and two Blade Flurries.
Mm-hmm.
And those little one drops are going to pop, it's going to die instantly, usually.
Yeah. I think it's actually really good against Warrior as well because the way you win this matchup, Rogue versus Warrior, is that you put Mint on the board that your opponent can't deal with early.
What was the worst one drop could come out? Well,
I want to say Kalenta's face. Oh, he did.
That's. Somewhat average.
Yeah, but now the Hungry Dragon doesn't die. It's just not dying.
Death is not upon it.
It's one of the much better ones than average, I think. Because usually, in average, I'd say you get 2-1.
Yeah, well, on average, I'd say...
You get garbage. I can tell you. You get a 1-1. you get a 1-1.
Yeah, generally, I think Argent Squire is one of the best 1-drops that your opponent can get. But in this situation, when the rogue has a dagger equipped, it's actually not too great.
Oh, wow. There's a Fan of Knives play. So, Fan of Knives would... I don't know. There's three possible line of plays for Orange. And I like pretty much all of them. It's just that with the Drake coming up next turn, it feels like sticking... Like, keeping the damage spells would be a lot better, especially with the prep.
I kind of like just fighting for board here.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, there is the possibility of prep sprint, but I think you can save that for a later turn.
Yeah, you don't even need to do it until you're in need of cards. Right now, you don't really need.
Yeah, I really like the Fan of Knives. Like, you could even, if you wanted, go for the prep. Oh, don't prep backstab. Mm-hmm. Okay, he's not. I was like, there's no way he preps backstab. He's going to keep the backstab for what comes out of the shredder. Hopefully it's enough, because sometimes 2/3s come out. The Monty Berserker. Oh, no problem.
Oh, okay. Not bad.
No problem.
Yeah, great sequencing as well. Just having the backstab just in case something bad came out. And yeah, this is actually looking decent for Arch. I mean, the Sludge Belcher is going to be annoying, but... At least Orange has some kind of follow-up, either the Drake or the Sludge Belcher or the Sprint.
Probably just Belcher.
Yeah,
so you want to protect that 3/3 against 3/5. Otherwise, it's so unfair to trade.
Harrison Jones.
Okay.
Yeah, I don't think Harrison's going to be used here, though. You really want
to save Taskmaster on Belcher to kill Belcher is so good. You're going to gate 3 from this at least, right?
Look at the value. Yeah, 3 armor points just off of a single Cruel Task play.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and even more, because the Sludge Belcher is hidden, or rather, the armor smith is hidden behind the Sludge Belcher.
Yeah, so there's a like there's a hidden Goldshire Footman within the Belcher.
You go with the Blade Flayer here.
You know, sometimes I wonder, was a slime a Goldshire Footman before it got eaten up? Like, is that what happens? When you get digested, you just turn to a slime.
Oh, wow, I didn't even think about that.
What?
Wow. Yeah, I didn't think about that.
Yes. I think he was overly
mind-blown. He's like, oh, God, yeah. My world has changed.
Like, yeah, I was like, Vasan, is there, like, an amazing play that I don't see here?
That's not it. No, it's just man.
Just that... Oh my god, that's what it is!
Like... That's a melted Goldshire Footman.
Yeah, well, Baron get an easy play here.
Yeah, I think so too, Baron and this is gonna put a little bit of pressure. A little bit, to say the least, actually, on... Oh, never mind, change of plans. No pressure was had on this day.
Yeah, just to be straight.
Those top decks. But you know what, Dr. Boom is always gonna be the answer here.
Against a rogue,
I mean,
you
I
mentioned
would
that,
just
right?
Go with Grommash here.
Or, oh yeah, Grom even here is fine.
Or Rag.
It's not like, well, we can play Rag, so why don't we play Rag? I mean, we're setting up lethal with Grom afterwards with Cruel Task, right?
Exactly. Like, all the cards, this is pretty much the previous turn is pretty much the perfect hand as Control Warrior going to turn 8. Like, these are basically all the cards that you want, right?
Yeah.
They're the best cards in the game against Rogue. You can't really sap Ragnaros because it'll just come back down. You can't sap Dr. Boom because you just give your opponent more Boom Bots. Your weapons are all locked out because of Harrison Jones, and then you're threatening lethal because of Grom and Cruel Taskmaster.
You see that beautiful game of ping pong?
Yep.
It's called table tennis.
Too bad it didn't hit the
noxious.
Oh, table tennis. My apologies. Wait, how much damage is that coming from... Actually, he's dead if he doesn't kill the Dr. Boom, right?
Yep.
Yeah.
But he doesn't know that.
Well, he will soon.
It looks like he's gonna kill it, attacking.
If he makes a trade. I think he does make the trade here. He does not.
Oh, no. Well, Kalento takes this game.
I think the reasoning was, I've seen one Cruel Task, and he can't play Whirlwind on the back of Lotheb. So the only out he's got to kill me right now would have to be a second Cruel Taskmaster, which is very unlikely with the amount of card draw that Kalento's had this game. So I think that was a good call from Orange, despite the fact that he lost the game. And Kalento's going to be up one game in this match here. So he has a chance to equalize, but his lineup isn't looking amazing for that, to be honest.
Yeah, I have to agree with you, Noxious. I agree with Orange's play because Especially because I feel like in that matchup, because you're already not favored, you have to take some risks. And Orange, I think he took kind of the appropriate risk there. Also, yep. Just judging by that rogue deck, again, like before I said that I've never seen Orange play like a minion-based rogue, but this is obviously a minion-based rogue with Sludge Belcher, Hungry Dragon, and Dr. Boom, right? And generally, that kind of rogue, I think it deals better against Warrior, but unfortunately, Warrior just like was too much for, the draws were too good for Kalento, or just even average for Kalento, and that was enough to take out this rogue that was even slightly more favored than normal against Warrior.
Yeah, Kalento's got a priest too, which handles, you know, minion heavy boards a lot better than the typical rogue decks. So yeah. Maybe the priest will be a bit better in this specific case, and you'll be able to take a second win, perhaps.
Yeah, exactly. Even though the minion based rogue, it's better against warrior, it's worse against priest. So overall, Orange is trying to make the deck a bit more consistent against the field, but in doing so, he's gonna give up the power against priest.
Yep. It's going to be also weaker versus in rogue matchup, in mirror matchup, right?
I mean, Dr. So Boom, Ragnaros, and Lotheb are really problematic for other rogues to handle. So it's going to have, it's all down to how they handle those threats and if you find them.
Yeah, well, I'm not
but
sure
Dr.
if it's...
Dr. Boom and... Go ahead.
Yeah, I'm not sure if it's actually worse than the mirror. Because if you... Dr. Boom is one of the best cards against rogue. And yeah. Also Sludge Belcher, you have to feel it's very good against rogue as well. The only card that I might question is the Hungry Dragon. Because your opponent could just sap the Hungry Dragon. And that's just a lot of value there, right?
That's right.
Yes.
Very early,
and
yeah.
Dr. Boom, also, you just... I mean, mirror matchups. A lot of rogues run Dr. Boom to start with. And that's kind of an obvious pick in rogue. So only cards you'd really added in is... like Hungry Dragon, and maybe if he runs Ragnaros. I actually did we see Ragnar Orange side or not? I don't think we did.
No, but after the Hungry Dragon, I'd have to assume there is some possibility, or at least a good one, that is there.
Yeah, mm-hmm. I actually have never seen Ragnar Rogue deck, though, so we do have to consider that. There is no really precedence for that.
Really? I've seen it all the day, like all day in Dog and Hyped. Like when they play tempo, those two players, I guess, are just like too much. They play so many archetypes that they're bound to have put. I saw Deathwing in Rogues in Dog's Rogue. Were you there when we saw that? Like, we've seen everything coming from Dog and Hyped at this point, so I'm not even surprised. They're both running Ragnaros, so it'll come down possibly to Orange. I don't know if he's playing the Malagos version, but with all the dragons, I have to assume there's some kind of dragon synergy lurking there. Unless he's just playing the Hungry Dragon for value. You know, you mentioned the good value that it has with Backstab, because it's so easy for you to remove the one drop with your dagger.
Oh, wait a minute. I just realized. He might just run them in instead of Wild Teacher, because Wild Teacher has been kind of in and out cards. You've been dropping them for Shredders. A lot of players has been, I think.
Yeah. I have to say, probably this isn't going to be a dragon deck, because we haven't seen any other dragon cards have synergy in that deck.
No Blackwing tech. We saw none of those.
Yeah, we didn't see any of the actual synergy.
Which
cards,
are actually pretty good as a tempo play in general, but... Actually, against Zoom metagames, how good is Blackwing Technician in a possible Dragon Rogue deck that Orange might be running? Because it is it's bigger than a 2-4, like, than a 2/4, which is okay. It's coming down the same turn that the Imp... The M Gang boss is coming out. It's taking it out plus the 1/1 that comes out the first hit.
Well, I think it's just Dragon Rogue is too inconsistent these days. Like if you put a lot of dragons in your rogue deck, like rogue has just so much stuff they want to put in their deck that it's really impossible to get value out of those cards. And also, there's oftentimes in rogue where you pretty much don't have any cards in your hand, and top decking something that needs dragon synergy is just too dead.
Oh, that's unfortunate. Hopefully we see something spring along those lines after the release of the Last Wing. Maybe we'll see something. I'd love to see Dragon Rogue be a thing. I thought Dragon, like Rogue and Paladin, were the two best classes for Dragon decks. Those were my assumptions, but so far, we've seen a bit of Dragon Pally on ladder. Not a lot at high ranks, but it's been seen. Mm-hmm. Just Dragon Rogue's just completely absent.
I just think there are too many removals that a rogue wants to have a consistent synergy. Because if you want the dragon rogue, you're not going to have any other minions out there, right? But you want some... Yeah. I guess you can have... Yeah, just drop the four drops and have the hungry dragon. to Rook.
Hungry Dragon made the deck a little bit more consistent. That's the big the blank I think that Rook, like Dragon Rogue had was the 4-drop. Like you have to play Violet Teacher or Pile of Shredders, but then why would you play that if you're trying to go Dragon with Azure Drake? So you end up trying out Twilight Drake in the meantime, and then Hungry Dragon comes out and solves the problem for you, where you actually get a good card instead. All right, well, it's going to be a Rogue Mirror Match next up. Kalento's not going for the Priest right up, so maybe he doesn't feel the deck. And you mentioned how tough the matchup was, and I think Kalento's got to feel the exact same way about it.
Yeah, I think it might just be that he wants more scouting info with his Rogue.
Oh, yeah.
Because I think Priest is one of those classes that really depends on knowing what your opponent has. Like, do I save my Cabal here? Is there a better Cabal target? Is there a better Shadow Madness target? Are there any death targets in the deck? And those are going to be really key pieces of information for Kalento to scout out in this Rogue Mirror.
Yeah, Shadow Ward Death is actually pretty solid for the Hungry Dragon openers that this specific Rogue deck could pull off. All right, wow, that's a fast hand for Kalento.
Yep, that's a really good starting hand because you can just mulligan the heavy ones and you're going to get the good ones, right?
Yeah, exactly, right? You just
pull
everything. Monk's not too confident in that mulligan strategy, Masan. Can you explain your thought process a little bit?
Well, if you have two sprints, like, you know that you're not going to get those. Oh, wait.
He's keeping one. All right.
Okay.
Kept the sprint in the mirror match. I guess maybe that's the edge he's looking for.
Mm-hmm. Well, you do have a combo already with...
Right.
Yeah, with prep sprint. So I guess that's okay.
Yeah. If you didn't have the prep, though...
Yeah. Kalento already winning with the coin.
All right, well, good game, guys. We can pack our bags. Wait, no, there will be a third game after this, even if he does win. Yeah, coin is a huge deal in the Rogue Mirror match. Like, it's a huge deal in every Rogue match, but...
In every control matchup, I feel like the combination of Violet Teacher, Prep, and Eviscerate is just so huge, especially against Druids. Orange, though, has some answers, though. Like, he can draw into an Eviscerate, maybe a Blade Flurry and a Phantom Dives.
Well, Kalento doesn't go for the
Prep. It's a really good answer for Wild Teacher, but the Kalento has a really amazing answer for Hungry Dragon, too.
Earth Ring Farseer value.
Oh, man.
Oh, my God.
That's actually really relevant.
God. Wait a minute. That's a poor clear, and...
Oh, but he can't use it. He's going to have to go for Backstab Eviscerate, like, I think.
Or you could just do that, right? You could just go for Thalmos and Eviscerate and run in the 1-3.
No, you keep the 1-3 for Earthening Farseer value. Don't do that. Like, you have to showcase how powerful of a priest you are.
Or you could just go for Thalmos, Backstab, and Deadly Poison.
You could take phase damage.
I think he'll just go with it. Yeah, you can take phase damage with Eviscerate as well. Because you have Farseer, right?
So. Yeah. Well, you're not going to draw a card if you do that. Wow.
Kalento, he just really wants that Earthring Farseer Northshire value.
Mm-hmm.
If he can get that off, he'll be like, wow, guys, look at that. Look what I can do.
Well, Fabi's amazing counter to Wild Teacher. Because you can't really do anything.
Yeah,
you
it's
can
pretty
prep.
Much it's the best counter in the game, I would say, to Violet Teacher.
Yep, you can also backstab.
And oh no, look at this hand. It's so many spells, and the most unfortunate part about this hand is that I feel like Kalento will have to heal himself with the Earthring Farseer this turn.
Yeah.
I think the play is to attack the Lotha with your face, heal it with Earthring,
get
a card draw, then smash your entire board into it.
Wait,
that is
get...
a play, but I feel like generally in this matchup,
yeah,
your health is really important.
Yeah.
Oftentimes it is a race.
So much of making the right call.
Wild Teacher. You're risking so much on Deadly Poison Blade Flurry in this case, though. Oh my goodness. Although your opponent doesn't have it, so that's the thing.
Yeah, he needed to re-dagger and go. If he had it, I think he would have played it last turn with a deadly. Like, re-dagger, deadly, hit Violet Teacher, then Blade Flurry for 3 minions. Would have been okay.
Mm-hmm. So would you go with the... Oh, he goes with Drake instead of dagger up and Violet Teacher.
I don't think that's the card he wanted to see. Is he thinking? No, there's no way he's gonna do that ever. You know, this is a pretty slow game for Rogue versus Rogue.
It's very slow.
I think part of that is because it's such a, like, Orange's deck is so minion based, so there's a lot of trading going on.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I still don't even know if that's that much of the medium based then, because I just think that he just dropped the shredder and put in Hungry Drifters. That's not too much difference than usual.
Yeah, but there is the Sludge Belcher, and there is Dr. Boom, and Dr. Boom I would say is in pretty much like 50% of Rogue decks. Sludge Belcher I would say is in maybe 20% of Rogue decks.
I can agree with that.
Instead of dropping Vi Teacher, I think he just dropped the Shredders.
So Ujo Sacrifice here, 1-3 here. I think I would.
Yeah.
Yeah, you've already used your Earthling Farseer. What value are you gonna get out of it? I mean.
Yeah, it's also not like it's not like the Rogue summons like dudes every single turn, right? For the 1-3 to clear.
Yeah.
Although there is a Violet Teacher in Orange's hand.
And there's a Phantom Knives in Kalento's.
True.
That kind of balances out. Oh, double prep. I think this is where you prep, sprint, concede.
Wait, what? No.
No, isn't that what you do?
You can't play it.
Of course. Oh, that's the whole point. That's why there's a concede at the end. Alright, so we have to... Like, Kalento's hand is filled with spells. He's got two decent minions, but how does he address the Drake? Does he just play his own Drake and then follow it up with a backstab for three and trade? Or does he play double deadly or a single deadly with SI?
I'm trying to think if there's any way he can backstab SI agent, but after that, you have four mana left, and there's not really anything good you can do with that.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you can certainly sap once again, but I think it'll just clear.
If he saps again, I'll be very surprised. I think the double deadly is probably a bit of a better play.
I think he actually values his saps in this matchup because he's seen his opponent has the Drakes. The Hungry Dragons, and also Dr. Boom and Sludge Belcher. So it's kind of an insurance policy at this point for Kalento just to save that sap in case a Sludge Belcher comes down.
Alright, Orange is gonna have to go on the offensive at this point. I mean, he's got the Blade Flurry. I think he's gonna have to use that. Unless he wants to trade away his Drake and play it a bit slower, but I don't think playing it slow is gonna be hyper functional. I almost feel like Dagger Up, Prep, Tinkers, Go Phase, Blade Flurry is okay ish. It's just so risky at this point. Like, everything he does, he's so far behind on the race. So far behind on the race.
Yeah, I have to say, like, he definitely wants to use his preps this turn because he's about to die, and when you die, you definitely don't want preps in your hand. That's basically just like, I could have done more. I should have done more. And it's like you're living with
regrets.
Worst
way to die.
You're living with regrets. Oh, wow, Monk. Poetry. All right, well, that's a board clear, and now Orange has a chance to kill Kalento if Kalento doesn't find lethal here. He doesn't have it yet. He's got exactly 5 with the Blade Flurry. Wipes the board, so he can actually get the edge on the race again by populating the board a bit more. I think that might be what he does, actually. Makes a lot of sense.
Drake and Blade Flurry to do the maximum damage. Or could, I guess, Redagger, but you might have enough to Redagger next. So I think he'll just go for Drake.
Yeah, I agree with this. You probably just want to draw deeper into your deck to draw into your oils or eviscerates.
I think there's one eviscerate left, so definitely what he wants to do. He's got the SI7 to go with the eviscerate if he needs to. Like, if you activate both with a combo, and he's already seen Lothep, so
that's actually pretty huge. This SI agent, because otherwise the Drake wouldn't have been able to be cleared. And now yet again, Orange sets up lethal.
Well, Kalento's got backstab, SI, Fan of Knives, with a sap as well. He can at least delay his demise for at least one more turn. If he doesn't find Eviscerate here. So. Wow, actually, backstab, SI, backstab, Vile Teacher, SI, 7, Vile Teacher, then Fan of Knives. That's perfect. And even has mana for a 4-drop on the back of that. Oh, wow.
Yeah, something like Vi Teacher, backstab, backstab.
Wait, do you start with double backstab? Like one on the SI, one on the Vile Teacher, then Fan of Knives in case you find Eviscerate? Then you can just kill him. I think that's going to have to be what he does. I think he does have the Eviscerate, right?
Yeah, you actually...
Or maybe he doesn't have it. Yep.
Yeah, he's not going for the...
I think with this play, he's actually going to sap the Vile Teacher instead of using the SI agent on it.
Yeah, most definitely.
The SI agent is going to give represent more damage for possibly lethal. Oh, wow. Ooh. That's really good. And you're not going to get too much value out of sap on the next turn, I feel. So yet again, it's a back and forth. And this time, it's Kalento that sets up lethal.
Could deadly poison help? So sprint, blade flurry...
You need to sprint.
Sprint is a guaranteed play. He's already used up two preps, though, so his only turn
good outs, then.
Is... The thing is, we don't... How close to fatigue is he? I haven't checked. He got his Drake sap, so he drew an extra card from that at the very least.
I don't think it's too close, but the problem here is... Oh, this is interesting.
Oh, my. He's just going to hope that he doesn't... Whoa. Wait,
Shadow
you can
Bomber.
Get that card?
Well, of course. It's a one drop.
I believe that's the first time we've seen Shadow Bomber in competitive play, but
I will make it work.
Yeah. Of course you will, Nashus. Yeah.
One day.
Yeah, that's unfortunately game. For Kalento.
For Orange, that is.
For Orange, yeah. That's gonna be it. Basically, and just one minion had to survive.
Reverse coming up?
Go ahead.
It's very possible. But as we have been hyping it up, it's gonna be... Rogue from Orange, and Kalento will be playing Priest.
That is going to be an interesting match. That's
gonna
crazy.
Be I think I would have gone with the on the last turn, just go for backstab and SS7 Asian, and then go for top deck SS7 Asian after saying thank you just to tilt your opponent.
Yeah,
but Kalento didn't do it.
I mean, Orange's top 5 spot is now gone. There's zero ways he gets there. Like, after the first loss, it was already out. But for the sake of getting the win against Kalento, which is good enough, you know, it's an achievement on its own. It's good enough to get. So if he takes that last game against Priest, which I think is more likely than not, then he's at least going to get a decent record at the very end.
Is it completely out, by the way?
He's definitely out.
So, a little unfortunate, but to be honest, as Orange going into this final day, I don't think he had too much hope of staying in this league. He'll have to try to re-qualify next season, and we wish him all the best of luck.
No, wait, yeah. I think it actually is possible.
What?
See, if Orange still wins everything from now on. And...
The tiebreaker is way too bad. Like, his tiebreaker
if
score...
If Dog loses a 0-3 to... What's his...
Orange is his opponent, I think. So that would
So if the Orange beats a Dog 3-0, then they're tied.
Yeah, but RDU and Amaz have to play too, so they have to lose as well. Which means if they do, then Trump wins, so that puts him up a little higher. Combinations of matches. If Orange ends up in the top 5, I will gladly give you the right of this, Masan, like, happily so. But now we're getting to the next game, Priest versus Rogue. I wonder if Kalento's going to get good enough start to contest the Rogue's general tempo game this matchup.
We have mentioned that this Rogue is actually not the best against Priest because it's very minion-based, and you just give more things for the Priest to interact with. That being said, this priest, even though it is Harrison Jones, it doesn't have Dark Cultist in it, which I feel is one of the key cards against Rogue, because I've heard from streams from, let's say, Just Saiyan, he said that you really want the, Hungry Dragon, want those kind of cards like the Dark Cultist, because that's the way you win. If you can get a Dark Cultist to stick on the board, it can often be very difficult for the Rogue opponent to clear everything because it has to get through everything with the Eviscerates and just straight up damage.
What's Kalento gonna do here? I mean, Hungry Dragon is probably not playable. Injured Blademaster with Circle is playing into Sap or an Eviscerate trade pretty heavily.
You could just injure Blademaster and the Naru.
Pass and heal it.
Probably wants to heal it as well.
Yeah, with Light of the Naru.
In here, play Circle.
Will we see a turn 8 Hungry Dragon Shadow Madness?
Oh.
Oh, that's the my dream. God.
Pretty sick combo.
That's the dream.
That is a dream.
I have to say
easily
that...
easily cleans this up. And
you
wow, this Rogue is...
too far ahead, though. I don't know if we'll get to that stage.
Yeah.
Well, Alcanine is still
just
freeze,
a huge
right?
lead.
Oh, there are good cards as follow-ups. There's a Shadow Madness to slow him down. Belcher might be a play here, I think, more so than anything else. Like, no other play really does anything besides that one.
Yeah,
but
also,
is it good enough?
Hopefully, it'll soften up your opponent's board enough that Shadow Madness will be able to actually kill off two minions instead of just one.
Oh, yeah, 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 you're right. Excuse me. Would you... This is a very awkward turn for Orange. Would you just want to Phantom Knights and hope that you draw into something they can deal with?
Well, Dagger Deadly and trade away the... I like Deadly Poison a bit more, but like it's probably personal preference at this point.
I think at this point, he just wants to get value out of cards that he doesn't typically get value out of in this matchup, because Phantom Knives, typically, it's pretty dead here. So you just maybe just want to get it out of your hand.
I can see that. I mean, the only time you really get value out of it is when the opponent has a Wild Pyro on its own, but you've already got SI7s and backstabs to deal with that. Oh man, this Drake's gonna be on 3 health. Good enough for Vile Teacher Shadow Madness.
Yep. Such a weak play, though.
Yeah.
Could be pretty
from
soon.
Rogue. I might have preferred the Azure Drake.
Oh,
and...
wow.
Whoa.
This is good. I'm liking this here. Like, the Shrinkmeister Shadow Madness could be amazing for Kalento in the next few turns.
Next turn, definitely.
Oh,
so you want to preserve... If possible, to preserve that Azure Drake, right? And Shrinkmeister is just gonna take... I don't know. Like, the Shrinkmeister could take Azure Drake and... just don't see clear play from Orange once again.
There's a Dr. Boom in Kalento's hand. You know, that's a really big problem minion for Rogues to handle. It's always an issue.
Especially with a Phantom Knight gun. Holy crap.
Yet again, there's only one minion on the board, so Shadow Madness won't get too much value. But I think Dr. Boom, as the turn 7 play, I think that's going to be it. And it's going to be especially strong against Rogue.
I was going to say, is Kalento hesitating? Nope, even he doesn't think too much about that one.
Dr. Seven, always to play.
Oh, whoa. No, you can't play Emperor here. You'll be dead by the time it does anything. You'll be long dead.
But I mean,
just
everything...
sprint here and hope that you get backstab, or, I mean, prep, possibly? Or would you just go for Drake and maybe it'll drain to Eviscerate?
Now, you say that, yeah, Emperor, you say, might be dead, but what other options really does Orange have? Like, basically, he needs to draw into something here. Blade Flurry, perhaps?
Ooh.
Sap?
Oh, I can smell the Shadow Madness from 10 miles away.
It has Sap, right?
I think he has to Sap. Unless he wants to take, you know, 7 to the face, which... I guess it's fine because it only leaves
possible.
Drake alive, but yeah, I think it's actually not that bad of a play. It's just like, how long does he want to extend his lifespan?
Yeah, trading into it, you take the 7 damage anyway.
Yeah, exactly.
And you play around Shadow Madness, I guess.
Yeah, I think that's probably what he's thinking about.
Because, yeah, he's probably thinking, he's probably not going to have enough damage to deal extra 14 damage in next, like, 3 to 5 turns.
Will we see Hungry Dragon with Shadow Madness here? I think we will. Oh, there it is.
Bill.
And, oh, ooh. Nothing. Well, the Boombots could win, right? It's a possibility.
Yeah.
It's
one out of four chance it doesn't kill Drake.
Yeah, it's most likely to kill it. So
it's
very likely.
So might as well just go for it since you made a play. Because you don't really have any other option, right? I mean, I guess you could go for Blade Master and Circle.
You're playing.
You don't want to leave.
Blade Fury is really hard, are you?
Mm-hmm. Thanks.
You've already seen a poison though, but I guess that doesn't say like, oh, my opponent doesn't have Blade Fury and he doesn't have Tinker Sharp Sword.
Whoa.
Well, Calento's gonna just get free Boombot value here by reducing the attack of the Secret Keeper to zero.
I actually didn't expect that play at all, but
no, I didn't.
Pretty interesting, because you do have two Shadow Manas in your hand, so you're kind of thinking you can combo them, but. I guess
I think the idea is to use Shadow Madness and Violet Teacher later on, or some of the 3-3s that they tend to play. That is probably the line of play he's taking. And Hungry Dragon goes back to the hand.
So you can just try it.
Yeah.
Chance number two.
He'll be able to get a Shield Bearer this time.
Noxious is calling it. I'm going to say Leopard Gnome.
I think Shield Bearer is the most frustrating minion of all. Of all of them, most definitely the most frustrating.
Yep.
10 health. Wait, how close is he? Does he have anything like lethal?
He has
Madness 4, Nova.
He has 5 damage from hand. And even if the boom pot hits for 4 to the face, it's just not enough.
Not this turn, but if Hungry
Dragon
over gets
2 turns, I think. If he goes for Hungry Dragon here and finds a Leopard Gnome and goes for Shadow Madness, that could actually set up lethal with the second Shadow Madness eventually. Is he just going to kill
it? No, he's just going for kill.
Yeah. Can't fault him for that. 1 damage.
Oh, no.
Yeah, Kalenta's just putting all the pressure on the board now.
Yeah. He doesn't even have to play anything else, honestly. And this Priest is doing amazingly well against the Rogue. At the moment, Orange is, like, even if he does get tempo back, I think it's just a matter of time before Calento finds the 9 damage. That's how it feels. He's gonna get at least 5 here.
Hungry Dragon's a little risky.
Yeah, really risky.
Oh no.
Okay, never mind.
Yeah, never mind that. Well, that's 4, 5, 6 damage. Well,
so
hello.
Close. Ooh.
Hello,
that's
Sylvanas.
Convenient.
Hey, guys.
So, would you play just Sylvanas and Hungry Dragon attack phase?
Yeah, I think that's what you do.
Even if your opponent can clear this board with, like, a Blade Flurry, then Sylvanas will steal something. So, he needs basically, like, Sap plus a Blade Flurry and some good follow-ups. Not to mention, he still needs, like, a weapon enhancer.
Yeah,
so
and he also
that specific combination of cards.
Well, Calento has Shadow Madness and Holy Nova anyway, so all he has to do is wait for a 3 attack minion at this point to get it done. Because with Shadow Madness and Nova, that's just enough to kill him at 4 if a 3 attack minion is played.
Hungry Dragon might just be a little risky if he summons a Shield Bearer, right?
Well, it's not just Shield Bearer too. It's turn 10 for a Rogue. You know you're going against Oil Rogue. So what if your opponent has a full combo? He hasn't really played that many cards from his hand because it's been clunky, but that's because he had so many minions in his hand, not because he had a combo. But Kalenta doesn't know that, right?
Yeah, I don't think he's aware of that yet. I think he's going to be able to wipe the board, but...
How is he going to be able to wipe the board? I don't really see a way right now. Oh, well.
There
we
go.
I guess that helps.
Also,
there's no prep, though.
Does it need prep? With the sap,
no,
yes, it does. You're right. Well, he could just... The thing is, if he just wipes the board, that doesn't really accomplish anything. Or does it? I don't think it does much. It's going to come down to backstab plays to try to... remove some of the stuff that's already there.
That actually might be good enough, since... Yeah, this might be good enough, actually. Because it's going to give him extra turn, right? Kalento doesn't have the damage.
Yeah, he can just Holy Nova and clear up this board, though. Oh, wait. Trickmeister, yeah. That's
no, one off.
That's one, yeah, one mana off.
Oh, man.
One mana off.
Well, Nova, I think, is the play. You just Nova.
Yep, Nova and just heal up.
Yeah.
Yeah, you can. Yeah, you can even consider just throwing down the Shriekmeister.
You've seen two backstabs. You're like, well, if he has an answer, then so be it. His face is definitely not one of them. He can't use a weapon. So Tinker's Blade Flurry, Deadly Poison Blade Flurry, probably. So Dr. Boom, Deadly Poison Blade Flurry.
Oh, oh my man, god, that feels so bad.
Yeah, but you kind of have to, don't you?
Oh. And if he does that, there's a potential for lethal.
With yeah, with Boomba RNG.
Still bomb.
Yeah, and you can reduce the targets because you can Shadow or Death.
Shadow or Death.
This could be a Boomba lethal from Kalento. This could be it. The moment we've all been waiting for. If it hits for one, this is going to be excruciating.
But it's 3 out of 4 chance, right?
Yeah, it's exactly. Amazing.
Oh, okay.
Well, Kalento's going to spot that one very quickly. What?
Whoa.
I'm disappointed, Kalento.
I'm disappointed, too. Do it, Kalento. Shadow Dead, Shadow Menace. You can even heal yourself.
Yeah. I believe in you, Kalento.
It is 3 out of 4...
I mean, if it goes wrong, right, what do you do? Like, what's the worst thing that could happen? You win later, right?
Your opponent doesn't have anything to deal the damage, so here it all comes.
Right. Guys, this is the moment of truth.
Yes, what is true.
It's and he can't use his hero power, right?
Is it Boombot? Is Dr. Boom OP?
Oh, yes, it is. Okay. All right, good. Wow, Kalento with the Boombot Shadow Madness play at the end. Getting a reverse sweep over Orange's 6th start and also winning against Rogue. That is an incredible feat. A reverse sweep is not something you see very often.
Yeah, certainly not. And Masan, I have to say, I don't think Orange's chances are looking very good for him to get into the top 5 now.
No, not more. I think, yeah, it's game time, so...
Yeah, it's game over at this point for Orange. Well, he's got another match to play later on versus Dog, so he's going to have to put on as much pressure as he can, I guess, because that way maybe Dog will get knocked out of the top 5 and maybe establish some kind of rivalry there.
Rivalry.
It'd be kind of fun. Just rivalry. How's the pronunciation of it?
Rivalry. But if you can't say rivalry if you want to rhyme it with chivalry.
Poetry, I said, Monk. You are a poet today. I don't know what's up with you. So the next match we're going to have is going to be Kaldi versus Amaz. Kaldi is currently in the top 5, in the top 3 even, with 5-3 as a score. Amaz is going to be his last match. Both of them are going to be playing their last match. I don't think there's a chance for Amaz to end up in top 5 unless... I think his tiebreaker is going to be what prevents him from doing so. Dog would have to lose, Trump would have to lose, and Kalento already won. So it's going to be down to Trump and Dog to lose the match for perhaps Amaz to go up. But if RDU wins versus Trump, then he's going to be ahead of Amaz nonetheless. So either way, I think Amaz is out of the top 5. So that's going to be the next match we're going to have. I wonder what classes these players will bring. I haven't watched much of Kaldi recently outside of KPL.
Yeah, well, he isn't really in, to be honest, a lot of tournaments besides KPL. So this is really his time to shine, and he's been doing a really good job lately. Getting, at least right now, I believe he's number 2 in the Horde division. So certainly making a name for himself there.
Yeah, Kaldi and Frezar both had a pretty rough start, but Kaldi just skyrocketed to the top of his group, just behind Life Coach at the moment, even ahead of Hyped, which is number 3 in the group. So that's definitely a good performance from him. And if he wins this, he's gonna he's getting into the top 3 for sure. I think no matter what happens, I think Life Coach would have to lose 0-3 and Kaldi win 3-0. To pass him, unless I'm mistaken.
No, even then, it's not enough.
It's not enough, because Life Coach wouldn't lose any tiebreakers. So, all right, well, Kaldi's at least getting in the semifinals. Very likely to be somewhere in the semifinals, which is something great, because it gets your reinvitation to Season 2 on top of everything else. So on this note, guys, thanks for watching the first match. We'll be going on a short break, and we'll be back with Kaldi versus Amaz. Don't go anywhere. Kingdom Pro League will keep going.